Hi there, I'm John Willsteed, and we're here at Vase, where they make beautiful amplifiers, and I'm talking to Ed Kuepper. We're both Brisbane boys, really. I grew up on the north side. I suppose you did too, in a way. Is it the north side or the south side where you are? I can't figure it out. The river's very confusing.
I actually grew up quite near where this building is.
Yep.
Just a couple of suburbs away. That's why I was able to direct you here.
So beautifully through the back streets of of Corinda and Sherwood. And I guess I was born in 1957. I guess you're born in the mid-50s as well. And so mid to late 50s as well. And so
60s.
Thank you. growing up in Brisbane in the 60s and 70s, you know, what was it like this far from the city, I suppose? You know, it probably felt a fair way from the city in those days.
It wasn't something that I really thought about that much. It was just, you know, what it was.
Yep.
You'd go into town when you went into town.
Yeah.
That's as a kid, you know.
Yeah.
Had a local cinema at Oxley and, you know, bushland, car paddocks.
Yeah.
That kind of stuff. It wasn't. There wasn't anything to compare it to, so it was what it was.
I think it's a fairly common Brisbane suburban growing up, what you've just described. Going into town on the train or on the tram, a local cinema, there are always paddocks just up the end of the street or around the corner or something.
Yeah, well, it used to be like that. I think it's sort of rapidly changing. There's a lot less of that kind of openness.
Yep.
But in those days, certainly.
There's less openness in the physical landscape, you know, with more building, but there's less openness in humans as well. The culture or whatever is very different. And your parents were migrants?
Yeah.
Were you born in Australia?
No.
Right. And so you were very young, though, when you arrived?
Yeah.
Yeah. Was there any element of that? Was there any element of caution, you know, in your growing up and your roaming around the idea that this place was a different or a dangerous place? Was there any feeling of it, you know, that was filthy hot compared to where you had been
I
born?
I think from my mum's point of view, I mean, she hated it.
Yep.
Took her ages and ages to sort of get a feeling of actually being part of the local community. In my case, once again, I didn't know. I was too young, you know, I was three or so when we came over.
And yep.
I couldn't speak English when I started school because we lived a fairly isolated. The first few years we lived further out.
Mm.
And that was I think it's called Jamboree Heights now, but it was just the bush in those days, in the olden days. And you just didn't see very many people, and the people that you did see were all migrants as well.
Yep.
Occasionally.
You know, yep.
Be somebody living in some, you know, caravan down the end of some dirt road.
Yeah.
A completely different sort of scenario to these days.
You went to school at Oxley or
no,
Corinda.
Primary.
Yep. And so did you have a was there music in your family when you were growing up, you know, a piano in the house or any of that sort of thing? Or?
No.
No.
My mum and dad liked music. We didn't always have a record player. In fact, I should listen to the radio. Mum was a sort of fan of Hank Williams and Elvis.
Popular music of that time.
Yeah, Cliff Richard, that sort of thing. You know, so I'd hear that kind of stuff on the radio. That was the sort of music that originally kind of got me interested. And I was pretty young, obviously.
And that's guitar-y music, isn't it?
No, it was just liking music. It wasn't until, I think, you know, specifically it was just hearing the opening bars of Love Me Do by the Beatles that kind of made me suddenly think, that's what I want to do.
Yeah.
Before that, it was, you know, just, it was there.
Yeah.
And I liked it, but I think the Beatles made me want to play guitar.
Yeah. Like a, like the, that, the, those lines, they're like a call to arms or something, or?
I mean, it was a harmonica.
Oh, right, of course it is, yeah.
But
very musical person.
I didn't think of taking up the harmonica. I wanted to play the guitar. My mum was keen for me to take up music. She wanted me to play piano, and I just sort of really held out. I think my dad was kind of more enthusiastic about buying a guitar than a piano. It's a lot cheaper.
Yeah,
yes. But they weren't cheap in those days. No. And so, yeah, they bought me a guitar.
Yeah. Oh, were you?
About 9, 8 Oh,
really?
Nine.
Yeah. Quite young, really.
Very young.
Yeah.
Still practicing. I'll get a good one.
Just starting to work it out now. Do you know what? Do you remember what sort of guitar it was?
I still have it.
Do you?
Yeah, it's a, it was a Hofner Club 40.
Wow.
It's the I remember seeing the Easy Beats on TV about 6 months after I got the guitar, and George Young plays the guitar in that sort of, you know, right up under his chin way of playing. And that was kind of great.
Yeah.
So I took lessons, and I mean, they never really taught me what I wanted to know.
No.
I wanted to play pop music, and they taught me the Sound of Music, and and what actually, I got to a certain point where I just had, I had to stop, because we got to the Don Andrews jazz guitar method,
and
I just hated jazz as a kid, and so Don Andrews is to blame for me
for everything,
for stopping for a while. I mean, I actually think some of the stuff is, you know, relatively quite nice, but not at that age.
No, you wanted something in particular, and so you had, in a way, you had to go and make it yourself, I suppose.
Yeah, well, after that, I sort of taught myself, and kind of just worked out a way of playing that sort of suited what I was doing.
This is before cassette players?
I didn't have a cassette player until my teens.
And so did you play along to records and have to keep putting the song on over and over again, or wasn't it about listening to other things?
No, I was never very good at actually learning other people's songs.
Right.
And never made much of an effort.
Right.
I stopped for a couple of years, just basically because I got depressed at the notion of having to play jazz guitar, and then took it up again in my teens. And at this stage, I sort of made friends with a couple of guys at high school that were playing guitar, and they were all much better at kind of working out how to play, you know, Deep Purple and rock and that kind of stuff. I could just never, you know, apart from getting some vague idea of what the chords were.
Yeah.
I mean, I just wasn't even interested. It didn't strike me as something to aspire to play these songs. I mean, I did the first band that I was in was essentially a covers band, but I, you know, they just heard me playing through this little Vadis amplifier, that little transistor thing, and I can't remember what I was playing, but they were looking for a guitarist, and so a couple of them came around because one of them lived down the end of the street.
Oh, it's at home they heard the sound from your house.
And I think they were a little surprised at how young I was, and I lied about how old I was and told them I was 16, and I think I was about 12 or 13 or something. They were all about 20, and so they were very gullible.
A week later, you were on a tour, you know?
Well, a week later, I was playing in pubs occasionally.
Yeah.
And, but, you know, it was a bit of a dead end. We won a talent competition at Kedron Park Hotel.
Nice one.
Yeah, and the prize was a trip for two to Cairns, which the singer and his girlfriend got, and the rest of us got nothing.
Just going back for a second, just thinking about that, I think about this as a teacher, you know, not that I do a lot of teaching, but it's, you know, it is still an interest. And that learning things by ear, you know, the ability to train your ear to pick up what the, you know, what the structure of something might be, what the intervals might be, what, you know, the difference in sound between minors and majors, or what major sevenths sound like. You know, regardless of what you do with that, what you play, is that something that you, I didn't quite get before, whether that was something that you're good at, or it's just something that you don't really exercise because it doesn't come into your mode of being. You don't hear songs and think, well, how does that go, you know?
I don't try to analyze things. I do hear similarities between songs quite often.
Yeah.
You know, where you just sort of, you'll hear a progression, but I don't sit down and
Play along with stuff.
Try and work it out. No.
No.
I mean, I think when I first, must have been like 15 or 16, when I first kind of got into some blues stuff, I'd play along to Jimmy Reed.
Yep.
You know, which is a fairly sort of basic sort of 12-bar
kind of
thing. Or when I tried to learn a little bit about playing lead, I'd play to a handful of B.B. King recordings but from a specific era where he was very sparse.
Yeah.
And the band kind of, there's a lot of organ in it.
Yep.
So that there was actually kind of a bit of room.
There's room to do stuff.
Experiment. But as far as trying to play like these people, never.
No. It wasn't about learning the solos. It was actually just a backing track for you to noodle on.
Basically, my interest from, you know, my earliest recollection, apart from, you know, when I was 9 or 10, when I wanted to play Beatles or the Monkees or the Easy Beats or something, when I kind of got back into it after stopping for a while, my only interest was in writing my own stuff.
Yep.
And that's what I did. And the guitar kind of just became, I don't think I even really analyzed a recording to the point where I'd break down everything into separate parts. I'd kind of hear what the band was doing, and then I wanted to be the band.
Yeah.
You know, so the way that I kind of started working on chords was maybe in a way where there would be a number of sort of harmonic overtones so that it kind of just filled out all the stuff that wasn't in the room with me, which was everybody, you know, the whole band.
It's the way the songs grow, the way the songs are kind of structured, is that a kind of a more organic thing as well? You know, you don't go into something thinking, oh, I'm going to have two verses and a chorus and a middle and two choruses and then I'm out.
Pretty much. I mean, I these days and for decades, I don't really kind of approach it the same way every time.
No.
I'm reasonably, but you know, talking specifically about those early years, I can't remember what I did. I just started writing.
Did stuff, sure. And so when you joined a band, were you still using the same gear? Did you manage to make enough money to buy a new guitar or anything, any of that sort of stuff?
No, the Hofner Club I used until the Saints had started, I was, you know, I
used, really?
That guitar was still my only guitar until I sort of saved up to buy an SG.
PSG, yeah.
The Hofner was kind of, I suppose, by that stage, felt like it wasn't quite what I was after. I'm not sure why, because actually, you know, it's quite an okay guitar.
Yeah, sure.
But maybe it's a very small-bodied guitar, whereas the SG just had something a little more magical about it, probably because, you know, I'd seen Tony Iommi from Black Sabbath and Pete Townsend. You know, that, and Mick. I think actually, you know, like three of the first records that I bought were probably things like The Who Live at Leeds, The Rolling Stones Get Your Ya-Ya's Out, Mick Taylor's got an SG, Paranoid by Black Sabbath. And so it's like the SG is kind of the guitar that kind of links the three. And so I think that had to have had a profound...
The universe was sending you a message.
It was definitely doing that. But, you know, certain Saints songs which are associated with the SG were actually written on the Hofner.
Yeah, right, yeah. Okay. It's not the Mick Taylor thing's nice. Mick Taylor on the SG, that's a lovely sound, isn't it?
I think all three.
Yeah.
You know, they're really kind of distinctive. They're all different from each other. And all of them had a... Well, with Mick Taylor, I don't know. I mean, I don't know of the Stones stuff. I'm not quite sure who
does what.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, but certainly as far as Townsend and Iommi, those sounds were very, very distinctive.
Yeah.
And there was something kind of, you know, this is the guitar could almost be there by itself.
Yeah.
And be the band.
Yeah. So it has a, you know, it's culturally powerful. The SG is, at that time, it's I used to draw guitars when I was at school, you know, that's what you do.
I did too.
Yeah. And I used to draw all those different models. I used to draw them in perspective, always from the headstock down. So the body was small and then the headstock was really big.
Oh, yeah.
So you're looking down the neck. And
mine were just really flat. Boring.
you're like an Egyptian artist. It's it took me out. But they stick in your mind, those things. You know, you draw those things, and they kind of, they build up a little. When you don't have an electric guitar, so you've got a myth in your head. Then that it took me. I used to draw Telecasters all the time. I drew all sorts of guitars, but Telecasters, I liked them because they were asymmetrical, and there's something about the shape that appealed to me. But I didn't buy one until about 10 years ago or something, so right through my life I didn't.
Is that right?
Yeah, and then when I got one, it was like, this is this thing that's been sitting in my brain since I was, 11 or 12 or however old I was when I first started drawing guitars. I have to ask you a question that I've made comments recently about the Saints and I'm Stranded and stuff, because people have been asking a lot of questions because it's 40 years this year. And so people have asked me because I'm supposedly some sort of expert. I'm not an expert.
Right.
But I have said a couple of times that, that I'm Stranded is connected to the, this punk wave which kind of swept around the world through a couple of years in the late 70s, and that which then became a post-punk thing and a new wave thing and a whole bunch of other stuff. But it was always my impression that you don't really, you as a band, but you as well as a songwriter or whatever, never really aligned yourself to that thing. You were just making what you were making, and there's something about the timing of it which was, I suppose, fortuitous or it's more like a coincidental thing or something. Do you want to just give me your thoughts on that?
Well, I guess one of the things that seemed odd to me was that the Saints, started in 1973, We were called Kid Galahad and the Eternals at that stage, Kid Galahad being the reference to Elvis, who I was a big fan of, the Eternals being the decadent immortals out of the early 70s science fiction film Zardoz, which stars Sean Connery.
A wonderful film.
It is. It is.
Do you dress up and, like that at home every now and then?
Only when Charlotte Rampling's around. She was one of the Eternals. And so that, you know, and then I don't remember how long until we changed to the Saints, but it happened probably about a year later or so. So there was this sort of this concept of the, you know, that I had when I asked Bailey and Ivor to, who were both very keen, which was great because we had a strong affinity in those days. And there was no scene. There wasn't anything to connect to. The sort of things that I identified with it all kind of finished.
What sort of things?
Well, you know, bands like the Velvet Underground or the MC5 or the Stooges had all just ended.
Yes.
You know, 72 was kind of the end of it. We started in 73. Yeah. Maybe the Stooges were still going in 73. I can't remember. The New York Dolls were kind of like the, and I kind of just avoided them because I thought they were just another glam band.
Yes.
You know, I really hated their their image.
Yeah.
And it wasn't until I actually heard the first record that I thought, oh, this is a band that's as rotten as the Saints.
Yeah.
So there you go.
Yeah, no, it was the look and the sound were quite
the
different.
Look, look to me was sort of like they just really came at the fag end of the glam thing.
Yeah.
And it you know, it had been there, like, you know, I had I bought The Man Who Sold the World by David Bowie, so the whole ultra kind of drag glam thing was new to me then, and that was a, you know, massively impressive album, the Bowie one.
Yeah.
But, and then, you know, T-Rex and Gary Glitter and that kind of thing, I liked all of that, you know, for a time, certainly the singles and that sort of thing. And the Dolls just seemed to sort of come at a time when there are a lot of cover bands in Brisbane already, like at the Academy of Music.
There were makeup.
Tons of bands that were doing this stuff, and I thought, it's just going to be more of
another
that.
Another one of them, right, okay.
And so I had no real interest until I just, one day, just bit the bullet, and I was sick. I was taking a day off work, and so I went into a record shop at Indooroopilly, Harlequins, that we were actually talking about earlier. Bought the first Dolls album. Got home. Luckily, no one else was home because, you know, I wanted to actually listen to it on the big stereo in the lounge room.
Dad's stereo.
which that, you know, there's no way in the world that my parents would let me listen to more than about 2 seconds if they were actually home. But, you know, it plowed through the first few numbers, and I thought, oh, yeah, there's something about the fact that they've just done 3 songs in a row and they all sound the same. I kind of quite like that. But then by the end of the first side, they hit this song, Frankenstein, and it was like, fuck, this is absolutely brilliant.
Yeah.
This is, you know, thing he's doing on the guitar, I'm doing that on the guitar.
Yeah.
And it was sort of like, okay, they look like dickheads, but I love them.
Yes.
And so I became a fan.
Yeah.
And it also, it was sort of a thing where you sort of feel, oh, you know, there is a kind of a, some sort of link going out into the world. And so, yeah, from that point on, But you know, the notion of punk, the word was around even in those days, but it kind of seemed to sort of refer more to a kind of a 1960s sort of garage band, yeah. like, you know, the Chocolate Watch Band or yeah. Blues Magoos. Those bands were called punks.
Yeah.
And so I quite liked that.
Yeah.
But when punk sort of hit in the mid-70s, it was that UK thing. And so that's, you know, we weren't part of that,
no, right.
you know. That, but it's the UK thing that had the influence on punk in Australia,
mm.
which happened a couple of years after the Saints. You know, we had split up
yeah.
by 78,
yeah.
and that's kind of when punk hit Australia.
Yeah.
When I came back to Australia, I got the Laughing Clowns started. That's when punk was hitting Australia.
1980 or 79.
79.
Yeah. yeah. And no, there was a, you know, you're quite right. It's a style thing, isn't it? The style kind of arrived yeah. via the enemy or the and some bits of video that yeah, was happening. Yeah. And though there were, you know, there's still a very strong Australian, for want of a better word, sort of punk, sort of Radio Birdman, you know, Ronnie Pino, the Hellcats. All that stuff was very American influenced still, you know, not very British influenced.
Oh, sure, sure. You know. That was a completely different thing. And I don't think that they sort of identified with the
same UK thing. They wouldn't. Either. No, exactly.
I didn't. I mean, but at the same time, the Saints weren't really connected with that either because no. they had a, you know, I thought Radio Birdman were a fantastic live band, but one sort of point of difference was that they had a very, very sort of reverential attitude to what was going on in America,
yep.
which we didn't. You know, I love a lot of music, but if it isn't sort of, you know, Bo Diddley or Chuck Berry or Buddy Holly or something,
mm.
I find it very hard to kind of
The
bands like the Stooges, Ron Ashton as a guitarist, yeah. major influence on me, but I still could not bring myself. I didn't think any of these people were gods. I just thought mm-hmm. they were great.
And so at that time, you know, when you got successful, when you're making music, that first album or two sort of thing, were there people that you looked at and thought, oh, I really love what they're doing, that, you know, this is kind of like not something that you aspire to, but certainly, especially if you're kind of looking around going, oh, there's an awful lot of sort of copycat stuff going on here.
Well,
what did you see that was...
There wasn't when we were doing our record. I mean, no. There wasn't anything else.
By the time, it was all over by that time. Were all over by that.
Yeah, well, yeah. The punk thing had the only influence that the UK punk scene had on me was just basically it kind of encouraged me to move on really quickly to kind of it was a combination of a few things. It wasn't just a sort of a reaction to what they were doing. It was also the fact that, you know, we did our first single in a couple of hours one night. We did the first album recorded and mixed over a weekend. The second album, we suddenly had 2.5 weeks. And so there was time in the studio and you could sort of think, oh shit, you know, I can do acoustic rhythm tracks on this sort of and blend that in with the guitar. You know, suddenly just learning about the process of recording because you have a little bit more time. So that was part of it. But I also thought the UK punk thing was really stupid a lot of the time. Mm. And I, you know, the Saints toured the UK in early 77 and it was quite a lot of fun. It was good. There was sort of fairly open-minded audiences out in the, around the country. We toured again 2 months later and suddenly it had become a very hard line kind of punk thing, and suddenly these people were sort of, you know, abusing Bailey because his hair was too long or something like that.
And hippie scum, spitting on him.
It was kind of like, fuck, you know.
Yes.
Who are you people to tell us what to do? And so, you know, it didn't impress, basically.
Sure.
And plus, you know, hard to believe as it is these days, but the UK press, you know, was also not particularly on side, even though there were a couple of journalists that were very, very supportive. But generally, the fact that we were Australian was just like, you know, the kangaroo jokes were just endless. You don't get that sort of thing at all anymore.
No.
So it's kind of hard to, but I have a really good collection of old articles, and it's absolutely, you know, I'll have to kind of digitize them and actually put them online, because the sort of stuff that it's quite quite damning in a way. Anyway,
and so then you invented the clowns, and did you move back to Australia to live?
I did. Yeah. The Saints had split up, and I was kind of, I had the idea for where I wanted the Saints to move musically, and that wasn't going to happen, just for a number of reasons, which I won't go into now. But the concept for the clowns was sort of bubbling away, and I'd basically run out of money living in London, didn't have a band, was having sort of problems with my girlfriend, and thought, well, I'll just pop back to Australia for a little while, say hello to my parents for Christmas, and lo and behold, I did that. I came back to Brisbane, and then suddenly on my door, Jeffrey Wagner, Bob Farrell, and Ben Wallace Crabb basically hitched up from Melbourne.
Oh, really?
On the, you know, just hearing that I was back.
Mm.
And it was interesting because with the exception of Ben, who I didn't know, the other two I was going to talk to, and they kind of preempted it in a way.
And you know at school or something?
Jeffrey and Bob,
yeah.
Oh, well, Jeffrey had actually played drums in the Saints for a brief while before I kicked him out.
Oh, that's fine.
Yeah.
And so those two turned up, and that was, and they fitted your little idea about where you wanted to take things.
Yeah, yeah, I think there was kind of a, they were certainly responsive to the ideas.
Yeah.
And then
was Jeffrey a great drummer in those days, you know? I don't know much about him until later.
So. I think he was taking lessons from a guy called Harry Lebler, and who was quite a renowned
jazz drummer
absolutely. In those days, and yeah, Jeffrey, after I booted him out of the Saints, took it seriously.
Yeah,
and then he would kind of just, you know, harangue me non-stop about things that Harry was teaching him, and I was absolutely not interested in the slightest. But,
you weren't interested in those paradiddles?
I actually wasn't. But, but yes, but we were... I think Jeffrey had a kind of a knowledge of traditional sort of big band jazz stuff that was able to be applied to what I wanted done in the clowns, because I wanted to sort of move away from rock drumming in a fairly significant kind of way. And
you wanted to get the brass in there and stuff. I'd
already been doing that with the Saints, you know, like introducing it on Know Your Product, and then Prehistoric Sounds, the last Saints album, was quite horn heavy in some ways. I mean, there's a lot of guitar on it. It's just sort of, it's maybe not quite as in your face. It's mixed back a little bit, and it's also very clean compared to the first album, where there's a lot of distortion used.
Yeah. You moved from Brisbane down to Melbourne, though, to do the clowns thing? Sydney. So you moved down to Sydney to start the clowns. And how long does that run for? How long does the clowns kind of exist as a band?
5 years.
Yeah, okay.
With a few different lineup changes.
Yeah.
yeah, I think also the first part of my solo career was another 5 years.
Yeah.
And then after that, though, it kind of started to get a bit more blurry. So 5 years and lots of threes. Something important about that.
Yeah. And did you...
The solo career stuff, it goes through a bunch of different phases.
Yeah. Well, basically because sometimes I'd use a band, sometimes I wouldn't. And, I mean, it's hard keeping a band sort of together, as you know.
Mm.
You know, especially if you're sort of operating in some sort of vaguely independent sort of way,
mm-hmm.
and you're not setting the charts on fire, which I've unfortunately never done. So, you know, financially it's always kind of stressed, and it is just basically hard to keep a band together. People get tired of being told what to do, and I get tired of telling them what to do.
Around this time, is this also when you first started having children and stuff,
that's right.
That also feeds into, you know.
Well, the clowns, first son, our first son was born when the clowns were going, and that was in London. We were based in London at the time. And that was really difficult, you know, because were some very needy people in the clowns, and when you then have children of your own, you kind of think, well, we can't all fit in the canoe, kind of thing.
You're out. Yeah. And so at some point then, when does it turn into just you and Mark, for instance?
That happened after The Yard Goes On Forever. Yeah. I think we
early 90s or something like that?
No, late 89.
Yeah.
We'd toured The Yard Goes On Forever. We'd toured the album Everybody's Got To for 18 months around Australia, Europe, and a couple of US shows.
Mm.
And I think, you know, it became unbelievably tight band, and you know, really quite impressive, but it also kind of just got fatigued. We had very little record company support. For instance, we had a tour booked of Europe. Every territory we went into was prior to the record being out. Mm-hmm. You know, there wasn't really any strong management backup, and the as soon as we were out of the country, the record company was on to whatever next, you know.
The Shantuzies thing was
basically. And so a lot of work went into it. The band was great, and you know, I forever am indebted to the commitment of all those people. But we kind of just hit a point where I couldn't keep doing it.
Yeah.
You know, plus I was also starting to, The Yard was a band where we would do very precise performances of songs from night to night. You know, they wouldn't really change.
Yeah.
And I was also starting to get sort of the idea that I wanted to break away from that musically, that I wanted to actually not go into sort of total improvisation, but where songs would kind of be deconstructed into what actually is that song. You know, it's this melody, it's this set of words.
Yeah.
What can I do? Pick the kind of things that are important to me and then basically change everything else around that.
Yeah.
From night to night. Just basically be sort of, you know, fairly free with the songs. And so doing that with a complete band was sort of something that just struck me as being way too hard. Also given the personalities of the people involved.
Yeah.
So initially the band had split up, and then I wasn't quite sure what I wanted to do, and then somebody suggested that I should do some solo shows, and I thought, at that point, that would be a really boring thing to do, is just go out with an acoustic guitar, and I didn't want to do that at all. So I started mucking around a little bit with an effects box with the I wanted it to be acoustic, but I didn't want it to sound the way that acoustics sound, plugged through a PA kind of thing, because I hate that sound. But I also wanted something else. I wanted there to be some kind of rhythmic sort of presence. And so I asked Mark if he was interested in this idea, and we had a couple of rehearsals, and it worked really great.
Yeah.
And so basically from there on, we started touring as a duo.
Yeah. This is at a time before the White Stripes, or before that kind of guitar and drums thing.
Way before that.
Yeah.
Different as well, though, because it was sort of the acoustic was going through a stereo effects unit, which made it sort of kind of big thing, with the drums sort of set in a fairly reverby kind of middle area.
Yeah.
So it was kind of cinematic in a way.
Yeah.
But very, very cheap cinema.
And he's got a very, there's a lot of dynamics in his playing.
Yeah.
So he can cover all that. He can be quiet behind.
I think he found it, and I don't often speak for other people, and maybe I shouldn't, but I think he found it an extremely liberating experience, because before that, we did have the situation where, the songs would be played identically from night to night in the yard, and suddenly I was actually saying, don't do it like that.
Yeah.
And so it was sort of fantastic.
Yeah. And the idea of opening something up, opening the ideas up and saying, I'll keep this, I'll keep that, but the rest can move and expand somewhat, that's really been at the heart of what you've done ever since then.
I move backwards and forwards on it. I mean, I've done a couple of albums that I think are extremely arranged as recordings, Frontierland and A King in the Kindness Room. I don't think you could get more.
Yeah.
We spent, I didn't, because I couldn't stand doing it, but Phil Punch, who was mixing it, just spent ages. I mean, it's very sculpted.
Yeah.
But generally, yes, it's kind of something that I constantly have to get back to. And I still think it's the best way of actually performing live.
Yeah.
And if you can capture that on record, which I think I have on the new one, it really works a treat.
Yeah. Where did you record your new album?
Well, where did I record it? I forgot. I did a bit of it at Gasworks and a bit at Electric Monk, just a little bit.
Yeah, okay.
A few bits and pieces.
And it's an electric album.
It's all electric.
What sort of electric guitars are you using for
semi-acoustic
335s
and a 345.
Pedals and stuff.
And you're playing acoustic live still at the moment,
I actually find the semi-acoustic is allows the dynamic of an acoustic guitar, but sounds better in a live environment, because acoustics, I still don't think that there's a really convincing acoustic sound through a PA system. Mm.
And the 345,
They're both the same size.
Same size. Yeah.
The 345 is a stereo.
Ooh.
Yeah. They started in, I think it was 1958, surprisingly, because stereo just come in as a format, for listening to music.
Yeah.
It was sort of the early days of stereo records coming out. And Gibson, for some wacky reason, came out with this notion that people would want to have a stereo guitar.
Like a pickup to each side of the stereo.
I'm not sure how it works because I use it in mono and...
What's the point of that?
Well, the point of that is that since that style of guitar has been devised, I mean, most effects, well, tons of effects boxes are stereo anyway.
Yeah, sure.
So in a way, unless you're going to go, I mean, I do play through two amps.
Yes.
But they're wired up. You have to use a special lead, basically, to make the 3-4-5 actually work as a stereo guitar.
Yeah.
From the guitar itself, as opposed to something that you're playing through.
Yeah.
I will do it at some stage. Gibson also, around that time, devised a stereo amplifier, which has kind of a front and then two angled speakers.
Yeah.
Which I actually used that amplifier, one of those amplifiers, on Frontierland, but I didn't have the stereo guitar time. So.
Yeah, it's funny those Roland Jazz choruses where the chorus kind of worked in a stereo manner in the
I never used the
120s. Oh yeah, it's the same sort of thing, like a stereo amplifier in one box kind of thing.
I guess in a way I was just surprised at how old the idea of that
stereo is.
Well, for a guitar.
I wonder where people plug them, because you know when we were young, I have to speak for myself now, but people had electric guitars or acoustic guitars with pickups in them before they had amplifiers. Amplifiers, I guess, were expensive, and so you used to plug them into your home stereo. Home stereos then had inputs somehow.
Yeah,
use the big Kenwood or whatever and make big woofy kind of feedback kind of things. And I wonder whether that the stereo thing is a bit like, a hangover from that sort of time. You have a stereo guitar, you can even plug it in.
Possibly. I mean, I had a little mono record player and I used to just plug that into my amplifier to get extra volume. So I worked in reverse.
And annoyed the neighbours.
Yeah, worked brilliantly, actually.
It's funny, though, also, that the idea of that, how old that technology is, the idea of a stereo guitar from the 60s,
late 50s.
When you look at film projection sound technology, people had surround sound systems in the 1940s, and then it all kind of disappeared because they were all... they used to do it in a really tricky manner, but then it all sort of disappeared and became all about Dolby stereo, and then surround came back again.
Oh,
but the technology was there, then abandoned, and then kind of reinstated or something, using different stuff. But
the same sort of thing is still happening these days to some extent, where you get kind of real advances in technology and quality, and then suddenly there'll be this massive reduction. Like we had the height of stereo recording was probably the late 1950s, early 60s, or something, when there was a lot of true stereo recording, and then for a while everything kind of descends into just little MP3s. And yet there's 10 years earlier, audiophile gear was something that you would aspire to, and then sort of everything kind of shifts to just being able to carry it around in your pocket.
I think it goes in waves, and it's amazing. I know we started recording music, I guess, in the 70s. By the time the mid 80s arrived, analog recording technology had been around for 50 years or more, and was at the peak of its kind of capability. So it was really sophisticated, and it had also gotten to be reasonably cheap. So you could buy some kind of analog recording stuff for home, a portable four-track a reel-to-reel tape machine, which wasn't prohibitively expensive. Are you still recording at home?
I kind of hit a... I do some work, but not after doing Generally in the Yellow Dog, which I found a fairly difficult project technically to actually be the engineer and to be the artist, and in a very limited space try to capture a sound that was you know, something that really required a much bigger space. I know that you can kind of simulate some bits and pieces, which I did, but I think you just, you know, recording drums was a nightmare. Working with the drummer was a nightmare.
But it's interesting, that process. Sometimes you go into that, you know, I'll do it this way because it's a new way, or it seems like, you know, it'll be cheaper and stuff. And the end result is that it ends up being more expensive, and that it sucks up your life.
It wasn't more expensive because I wasn't sort of paying myself to be doing it, but it was time consuming. But one thing that I took away from it was that it is actually quite good to have somebody else doing the engineering at the very least. I mean, sometimes I even like to have somebody, a third person, sort of just to have a, you know, a different opinion on things. But certainly as far as performing, you know, not being concerned about whether things are, you know, are out of phase, that sort of thing. You know, that's actually really great when you're trying to do a performance.
Yes.
And
you just want to go into a room and do the thing.
Yeah.
Let somebody else take care of all the stuff.
Exactly.
Yeah. And you like, you know, you're a big room person, you like a big wooden room, or when you're recording to play into?
I love, you know, massive rooms and, you know, big houses and all that kind of thing. And one day I will.
All right. Well, look, I don't know. We're probably at the end of our moment here. So, John Willsteed, head of music at QUT, Ed Kuepper, the king of Oxley, and I suppose we might come back again and have a chat about new things, or we might even come back and have a guitar ramble one day or something.
All right,
if you feel like it.
Sure.
All right. Good. Bye.